online praise and worship service. Blessed Sunday to all of you. Although we are separated physically, we are together as a body of Christ connected. It says in the word that when two or three are gathered in his name, that he will be there in our midst. So even as we gather together as families or as individuals in front of our devices, we pray that it will be a blessed and an anointed service to all of you. Shall we commit this time to the Lord? Heavenly Father, we come before you today and we thank you and praise you because you are a good and a mighty God. You are a God who deserves honor and praise no matter what circumstance, Father. Lord, even as the world around us and especially in our country is filled with darkness and challenge, Lord, we commit it into your hands. Father, we pray that you will shine your light in our lives and through us to this country, which is in desperate need of you and your love and your guidance, Father. Lord, we pray and commit our families that come together to worship you. Lord, as we come as one family of St. Luke's to join in worship and listen to your word, we pray, Lord, that you will anoint the service, Father. Lord, we pray that every home that is gathered in your name will be a sacrifice, will be a place of honor to you, Father. Lord, we pray and commit this service into your hands. In Jesus' precious and mighty name we pray. Amen.
As we gather in this place today, Holy Spirit, come and have your way. Have your way. As we lay aside our old desires, sweep across our hearts with dare not trust the sweetest praise, but only trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust.
As we continue our time of worship, let's just look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord, and we acknowledge that you are the cornerstone of our faith and our belief. Jesus, even as darkness is seen all around us, especially in this time, we know that as Christians, our faith must rest on you and your unchanging grace. Lord, give us the ability to submit to you, Father. Lord, forgive us that often we are submitting to a spirit of fear which does not come from you. Lord, it says in your word that you remove the spirit of fear, but instead fill us with the spirit of power and love and self-control. Your power, like the psalmist, Father, give us that power that helps us to say that, Lord, you are our refuge and our shelter, and that you will save us. Father, give us the power to pray healing of body and mind to all those who are faced with illness at this time. The power to proclaim that your salvation, to acknowledge that your salvation is what saves this world that is completely lost, Father. Lord, ensure that we as your children act with self-control rather than selfishness, which is prevailing in this time of curfews and lockdowns. But Jesus, above all, fill us with your Christ-like love to share about you and to share you through our lives in the way that we act and the way that we behave in this time where the world is so desperately in need of your love. Lord, as you fill us with your assurance, we claim with faith to your promises, because we know and believe in the greatness of you. The greatness that deserves all the honor and praise that we can give with our entire heart, Father, with our entire life. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for the greatness of you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Wanna sing of your love. Wanna sing of your mercy. Wanna tell the whole world of the greatness of you. So I'll sing of your love. And I'll sing of your mercy. I'll tell the whole world the greatness of you. Jesus, we lift up your name. 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 Wanna sing of your love. Wanna sing of your mercy. Wanna tell the whole world of the greatness of you. So I'll sing of your love. And I'll sing of your mercy. And I'll tell the whole world of the greatness of you. Jesus, we lift up your name. Jesus, we lift up your name. Jesus, we lift up your name. You all, give me praise to lift you all, everything to lift you all. Your name is higher than the heavens, greater than the nations, Jesus. Your name is higher than the heavens, greater than the nations, Jesus. Jesus, we lift up your name. 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 Jesus, we lift up your name.
May the gracious and merciful God grant to you pardon and remission of all your sins, time for newness of life, and the grace and comfort of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The reading is taken from Exodus chapter 27, reading from verse 9 onwards. The courtyard. Make a courtyard for the tabernacle. The south side shall be 100 cubits long, and is to have curtain posts and 20 bronze bases, and with silver hooks and bands on the posts. The north side shall also be 100 cubits long, and is to have curtains, with 20 posts and 20 bronze bases, and with silver hooks and bands on the posts. The west end of the courtyard shall be 50 cubits wide, and have curtains, with 10 posts and 10 bases. On the east end, towards the sunrise, the courtyard shall also be 50 cubits wide. Curtains 15 cubits long are to be on one side of the entrance, with 3 posts and 3 bases, and curtains 15 cubits long are to be on the other side, with 3 posts and 3 bases. For the entrance to the courtyard, provide a curtain 20 cubits long of blue, purple and scarlet yarn and finely twisted linen, the work of an embroiderer, with 4 posts and 4 bases. All the posts around the courtyard are to have silver bands and hooks and bronze bases. The courtyard shall be 100 cubits long and 50 cubits wide, with curtains of finely twisted linen 5 cubits high and with bronze bases. All the other articles used in the service of the tabernacle, whatever their function, including all the tent pegs for it and those for the courtyard, are to be of bronze. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hi everyone, a very good evening to all of you as we come together to study God's word during this pre-recorded service. And we are continuing with our progress on tabernacle and the temple, God's dwelling places. And today we come to the fence and the gate. That's our next topic. John chapter 5 verse 24, very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. So the fence itself is quite in detail. So we will we'll study the fence today and we'll go to the gate, God willing, next time. Again, John chapter 10 verses 7 to 10, these are very important verses from our Lord Jesus. Therefore, Jesus said again, very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. So the Lord is very clearly teaching us, using the imagery of the tabernacle and the temple, about him being the gate through whom we can enter and find pasture. Dr. Woodrow Kroll, the former president of Back to the Bible, made this statement once, and I quote, the world has many religions, but only one Savior. And this concept is seen in the tabernacle, and we are going to look at the fence initially. But before that, in the passage that was read to us, we have the structure of the tabernacle. And once we understand the structure of the tabernacle, then we will understand the fence and the gate. Now, the structure of the tabernacle is something that I shared with you previously, but let me share it again just to remind us of what we have studied. So if you look at this picture, you see right in front, you have the gate, and surrounding the tabernacle courtyard and the tabernacle premises, you find a white color made out of white linen fence, and that is also propped up by a lot of fences. And this is what that we are going to look at. A lot of posts are there to prop up this fence. So the children of Israel first come to the outer court to establish a relationship with God. And this is something that we have seen. They enter through this gate. Remember, there is only one gate, and the gate symbolizes the Lord Jesus Christ. They enter through the gate and they come to the altar, the bronze altar. And that's where the sacrifices are made. That's where their relationship with God is restored. And then the priests go up to the bronze basin where they wash themselves, cleanse themselves before they go into the tabernacle proper. And this is what we are going to look at now. So they enter through the eastern gate and they come up to the bronze altar and the bronze laver. The outer court, which surrounded the holy place and the most holy place, which is the actual tabernacle, was 150 feet by 75 feet. Those were the dimensions, or 46 meters by 23 meters. Now, this was not a very large area, but this was adequate for people to come together to meet with God. Now, this is yet another picture of the tabernacle and the courtyard with the right dimensions. So only a few hundreds or a couple of hundreds could come in here at any given time. In the center of the outer court was an enclosure. That is the tabernacle that you can see there, the tent-like structure that you can see there. Now, this was divided into two compartments. The entire tabernacle was 45 feet by 15 feet, and its height was 15 feet, or 15 meters by 5 meters, and the height was 5 meters. The initial room, or the first room, as you enter into the tabernacle, which was next to the outer court, beyond the bronze laver or the bronze basin, was the holy place. And the holy place was 30 feet by 15 feet. And it was a place of fellowship. And only priests could enter into the holy place through a second curtain. Firstly, you have the gate, then you have the curtain. They entered through that curtain door into the holy place, and only the priests could enter in there. And this is what you find inside the holy place. As you enter, on your right-hand side is the table of showbread. And the right-hand side would be the northern side of the northern direction of the tabernacle. And on the left-hand side, on the southern direction of the tabernacle, is the menorah, or the lampstand, which gives light. Then, straight ahead, towards the veil that separated the holy place from the most holy place, was the altar of incense. So beyond the holy place, beyond the veil, was the second and the innermost room, which is the most holy place, or you find it in the King James Version of the Bible, being referred to as the Holy of Holies. Now, this room was a perfect cube. That means it was 15 feet in every part of its dimension. 15 feet in length, 15 feet in width, and 15 feet in height. Remember, the total length of the tabernacle was 45 feet. So 30 feet for the holy place and 15 feet for the most holy place. So the most holy place was a perfect cube. There is one other cube means all same size, all parts of its dimension were same size. There's only one other perfect cube in the whole of the scriptures, and that is the New Jerusalem, or the heavenly Jerusalem. And that's where we are going to be spending all eternity, forever and forever. And inside the most holy place, this is a picture of the high priest who can enter into the most holy place only one day of the year, on the Day of Atonement. And he will go in there and he will carry two things in his hands. Firstly, you can see him burning incense, that on the one hand, and on the other, you see that the other little receptacle, that's on the left-hand side, that's where he carries the blood of the sacrificial animals to be sprinkled on top of the mercy seat. The mercy seat is the lid, you can see here on the left-hand side, on top of the Ark of the Covenant, and on the lid you find two cherubim with their wings outstretched. And across and all around the Ark of the Covenant also, this the high priest must sprinkle the blood of the sacrificial animal. And if the holy place was a place of fellowship, the most holy place was a place of worship, because the mercy seat was there. As I said, the entrance to the most holy place was highly restricted, only given to the high priest once a year on the Day of Atonement. And the veil separated the most holy place from the holy place. Thus, the veil was symbolic of entrance into God's very presence. So the Lord Jesus referred to himself as the way and as the door. John 10, 1 to 2, John 10 and verse 9. John 10, 1 to 2, very truly I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters the gate is, the one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. John 10, verse 9, I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. So the Lord Jesus Christ made access to God possible for all of you, all humanity, when he shed his blood on the cross and gave his life as a ransom for ours. Hebrews 10, 19 and 20 speaks about it. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body. You notice that I said that, if I go back to the previous slide, that the Lord Jesus made access to God possible for all human beings, for the whole of humanity, does not mean the whole of humanity is going to be saved. Only those who accept this free offer of salvation given by God. Sadly, many will reject it in their blindness. Now we come to the next item, which is the curtain wall of righteousness. That is the wall around the tabernacle premises. So the outer court is covered by a fence. Obviously, that fence is like a wall. Now, the measurement of the courtyard is given in Exodus 27 and verse 9. Make a courtyard for the tabernacle. The south side shall be 100 cubits long and is to have curtains of finely twisted linen. In the Old King James Version, fine twine linen. Now, since a cubit is about 1.5 feet, one side of the tabernacle was to be 150 feet long. Now, that is the side of the tabernacle. Not the front and the back, the sides had to be 150 feet long. The southern side and the northern side had to be 150 feet long. The width, that is the eastern side and the western side, had to be 50 cubits, means 75 feet. Exodus 27, 13, on the east end, toward the sunrise, the courtyard shall also be of 50 cubits wide. Now, why was the outer court necessary? Couldn't God have just given us the tabernacle itself? But he sets up an outer court and then he puts a fence around it because God demands absolute separation. Why is there separation between God and man? Because of the sin of humanity, the sinfulness of humanity. Now, God is spotless, without blemish. Absolutely no sin is found in him. He is absolutely holy. Therefore, God's presence cannot be contaminated by sin of any kind. So God was shut in from the world, and the world was shut out from God. That is the lesson, the primary lesson that we learn from the structure of the tabernacle and its outer wall. Now, the wall of the outer court served as a fence that surrounded the tabernacle, and the only opening was on the east side. The front part of the tabernacle faced the eastern side. And as we have seen, the wall or the fence was made out, not out of bricks or leather or anything. It was made out of finely twisted linen or fine twine linen. Exodus 27 and verse 9. Now, this picture gives you an idea of this. You can see this white color fence. That is the fine twine linen or finely twisted linen. Now, why did God choose fine linen to represent the fence? Because the fine linen represents righteousness. Revelation 19:8, fine linen, bright and clean, was given to her to wear. Fine linen stands for the righteous acts of God's holy people. So when people approach the tabernacle premises, as they see this fence, as they see this fine linen, they see or they are reminded of righteousness. I'm often reminded that at baptisms and at confirmation services, the participants wear white, or they are requested to wear white. Why? Because to show them or to remind them of righteousness. At the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, it's interesting to note that the heavenly armies, the army of heaven that will come with him, will be dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Why? They're coming to battle in righteousness. Righteousness is what God is waiting to give us through his redemptive act. So the fine linen indicated that the court of God was encircled with the righteousness which God demands. So this linen was hung on pillars, and it was too high for a person to climb over. I'm often reminded that as I drive down Alvitikala Mavate, which leads to my house, you know, quite often I see, you know, you have the separator in the center island, or center aisle on the road. The whole idea of having that metal separator is that people don't just cross everywhere. But many times I notice people just coming, jumping over that, and breaking the road rules, which is very normal and common with us Sri Lankans. So this fine linen fence was very high so that no one could climb over it. And they had to come around and come through the only gate that was permitted. Why? There also, there is a lesson for us. Because no one could scale the wall of righteousness on his own. Every person had to enter by the gate that God had provided. In other words, we that do not have the righteousness that is required to come into God's presence. We do not have the righteousness that is required to enter heaven. We do not have the righteousness to have eternal life. So God has to impute or credit or give that righteousness to us. So the curtain wall of righteousness barred everyone, whether that person is a terrible or a gross sinner or a very self-righteous person, whether he's a Pharisee or a thief on the cross, none of them could be saved because all of us lack righteousness. For all have sinned and come short or fall short of the glory of God. So that reminds us that this righteousness must be God-given. One of the aspects of this fence are the pillars. Now, if you looked at that picture, you notice that there were pillars that supported this fine linen. They kept this fine linen up. And there were 56 pillars. Four more pillars held up the gate to the outer court. So altogether, making it a total of 60 pillars. So remember, to hold up the gate on the eastern side of the fence, there were four pillars, and then 56 pillars surrounding the tabernacle premises. You can see this is what it would have looked like. Pardon me if the picture is not very clear. You have these are the pillars, and here you can see you have the white fine twine linen fence. The curtains were held up by pillars so that the fence itself was 7.5 feet in height. So that is about, much more than an average human being's height. So can you even look into the tabernacle courtyard? No, because remember, each generation is getting taller. My kids are taller than me. But during the time of the journey through the wilderness, we are talking about almost 3,400 to 3,500 years ago, the average height of a person was about 5'4 to 5'6. This is more than 2 feet higher than that. So no one could look inside. Means you cannot even get a glimpse of God. Why? Because you are unrighteous. That's a principle that this teaches us. Exodus 27:18. The courtyard should be 100 cubits long and 50 cubits wide, with curtains of finely twisted linen, 5 cubits high, and with bronze bases. The pillars were set in a bronze foundation, which enabled them to firmly uphold the fine linen representing God's righteous standards. Now, why bronze? Bronze represents judgment. And this is precisely what anyone who tried to climb over the fine linen curtain would have experienced. In other words, anyone who tries to save himself or save herself through self-righteousness will face God's ultimate judgment of hellfire, Gehenna, or hell for all eternity. So you notice that bronze is the most widely used metal outside the tabernacle premises, outside the tent. Why? Bronze symbolizes judgment. So everything outside the tabernacle, the tent itself, outside the tent, reminds us of the fact that our sins have to be judged. Then in addition to that, the pillars were crowned with silver. On top of the pillars, you had silver. Not only that, hooks of silver held the curtain to the pillar. And rods of silver connected the pillars. Bronze and silver. Bronze represents judgment. And silver represents redemption and righteousness. Redemption. And the fine linen symbolizes righteousness. So the unbroken line of silver, that's what held up the pillars and connected the pillars with the fine linen. It went around the courtyard. And this symbolizes the redemption and righteousness that come from Christ. The silver speaks about redemption. Remember those days, if you want to redeem a slave, it is not gold, it is not bronze. You have to give silver coins to redeem a slave. Even when you are sold into slavery, you are paid in silver. So remember Joseph, silver. Then the Lord Jesus, the great betrayer, Judas Iscariot, he received silver coins. So silver symbolizes the redemption that we have in Christ, and the fine linen symbolizes the righteousness that we have in Christ. In other words, when we trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, that redemption imputes or credits or gives to us the righteousness of Christ. That's what makes us qualified for heaven. See, the law of God demanded perfect obedience, not 99.99% obedience, but 100% obedience, which none of us have done. James 2:10, for whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. See, if we keep 99% of the law, just fail in one area, just some tiny part of the law, we have sinned, then we are as guilty as having sinned against God, because God demands 100% righteousness from us. Now, most scholars are of the view that there are 613 commandments in the law of Moses. You know what? None of us can keep all 613. In fact, throughout human history, there's only one person who kept all 613 of these commandments, and that is none other than our Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why he was perfect and he is perfect, and that's how he became the perfect sacrifice for our sins. You know, even if you keep 612, you fail in one, you stumble in one, you are as guilty as having failed in all. God cannot accept man's righteousness because our righteousness is nothing but failure. Isaiah 64 verse 6, all of us have become like one who's unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. Whom does Isaiah mean by all? Every single human being. Romans 10, 1 to 3, brothers and sisters, my heart's desire and prayer to God for the Israelites is that they may be saved. For I can testify about them that they are zealous for God, but their zeal is not based on knowledge, since they did not know the righteousness of God and sought to establish their own, means establish their own righteousness. They did not submit to God's righteousness. So those who wish to find true righteousness must find it in Christ. They can only find it in Christ. Romans 10:4, Christ is the culmination of the law, so that there may be righteousness for everyone who believes. Means Christ is the one who fulfills the law, culmination of the law. So for those who believe in Christ, there is righteousness. 1 Corinthians 1:30, it is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Jesus Christ, our righteousness, our holiness, and our redemption. Thank you for joining us today. Keep safe, take all the necessary precautions, and God will protect you. And next time, God willing, let's look at the gate. Till then, be in God's presence, be in prayer, and obey God's word. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you and praise you for this wonderful time that we have spent together. Even though we cannot come face to face, we thank you that you have given us the technology to come together. Thank you, Lord, once again for the timely reminder that none of us can achieve salvation or redemption through our own righteousness, because all our good deeds are like filthy rags in your sight. But we thank you that by believing in Christ, we receive the righteousness of Christ that qualifies us for heaven, that makes us perfect in the sight of God the Father. Thank you, Lord, once again. In Jesus' name, Amen. God bless you.
Let us come before the Lord with thanksgiving and offer our petitions unto him. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Lord, our Creator and Provider, our refuge and strength, your word reminds us to rejoice in you always. Yet, when sickness, fear, uncertainty, and death surrounds us, our eyes are momentarily shifted from you to our circumstances. We are often crippled by a sense of hopelessness. But we come before you today with hearts filled with gratitude for your faithfulness to see us through all the storms of our lives. Thank you for being our strength, our shield, our anchor and our protector, our provider and comforter. Thank you for your grace, mercy and healing. Help us, Lord, to count our blessings and live each day with an attitude of gratitude, knowing that you never leave us nor forsake us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, when you formed the universe out of nothing, with such an amazing vision and a desire for wholeness and abundance, it was your intention that we, as your sons and daughters, created in your image, would take dominion over the universe with godly wisdom and a heart of service. Forgive us, Lord, for we have failed you and have failed to use our resources responsibly and preserve Mother Nature. In our greed and hunger, we continue to live like beasts, failing to love like you loved us. Instill in us hearts filled with generosity, kindness and love for all of God's creation. Strip from us our human ways and fill us with your Spirit so that we may bear the fruit of the Spirit in us, nurturing and caring for the environment, our fellow brothers and sisters, and all creatures, great and small. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the family unit during these times of uncertainty, that your Spirit will move in a mighty way, transforming hearts, minds, thoughts, and desires. We pray for parents, husbands and wives, children and extended family, that they may find creative ways of rebuilding bonds, reconciling and living in harmony, discovering ways to connect in mind, body and spirit. May channels of communication be opened, let there be reconciliation in relationships and an abundant outpouring of your love. Let there be a spiritual revival in every home as they intentionally gather to spend time worshipping you, studying your word and praying as one family in one accord. We pray against the spirit of separation, depression, anxiety, hopelessness, frustration, anger, disappointment, discouragement, and pray that you would protect and shield all those who may be subject to abuse of various forms during these times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we bring before you all those who are impacted in numerous ways due to the COVID pandemic. We thank you for all those who risk their lives and continue to work in the front lines to provide support in the battle against this virus. We pray for all those who are sick and are suffering. May your healing hand be upon them, O Lord. We pray that as we raise our hearts and minds to you, may your Spirit touch each patient in every hospital bed, in every quarantine center, every home living in isolation. Touch them from the very tip of their heads to the very soles of their feet. Let your cleansing blood flow through their entire beings. We pray for a global wave of your healing touch to flow, even as they wait on you, Lord, for complete healing and restoration. Open their hearts and minds to seek you in a deeper and meaningful way and to surrender their hearts to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray that you would use the church as a mighty instrument in your peace and love during these times. Pray, Lord, that you would enable us to be relevant and to be sensitive to the needs of your people. We pray for our church, our shepherds, Bishop Doshi, Reverend Krishantha, Reverend Suresh, Reverend Mohorty, Brother Dino and their families. For all the lay leaders and members of all the ministries in the church, that we may continue to grow closer to you, that we may spend time in stillness listening to your direction in our lives, and that we would be moved to action and service, energized by your Spirit. Help us to reach out to every believer, to strengthen them in their faith and continue to bear strong witness to those around us. Lord, in your mercy. Finally, we pray, O Lord, for the leaders of this nation and global leaders, for members of parliament and officials in all organizations working in influential positions at every level. Pour out your godly wisdom in all their decisions. Strengthen all whom you have placed as change agents to provide the right counsel and direction which flows from you. Pray, Lord, that you will tear down all plans which are designed to destroy and harm, and bring the individuals who scheme and plan that which is evil, ungodly, unjust, unfair, and inhumane. Raise up a chosen generation that will march through this land, bringing about love, peace, joy, unity, and prosperity in every industry. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore. Amen.
You know.